13, which is considered to be extremely auspicious day in Europe and especially in France. So it does not happen so oftentimes. Thank you so much for this. And I hope I will be able to fit in your attend. So I choose this conference, this topic, because it is a kind of resume of what I did on the northeastern border of Nepal in 1980. So I had the chance to try to get to this northeastern border of Nepal, and especially in Walung Chungola, and at that time it was a restricted area. So I went without any permit, and I could reach this village, which was at that time a very important point. I will explain you know, the whereabouts, the situation. So this is a picture of actually Sikkim. I took this picture of Kanchenjunga seen from Sikkim. And so I explain now why I illustrate this question of globalized capitalism. Okay, so let's start. I call this the last opening of Beyul, it is Tibetan. Beyul, you know, the meaning, it means hidden place in Tibetan. So the last opening of the Beyul of Shingsa Walung, it is Walung Chungola in Tibetan. So what happened in this place? Many things happened. So in fact, what do I call this last opening? You can read the text. You see from here, is it clear? Okay, so it was announced on the 22nd of July 2017, it was announced in the Nepalese press that Tapajung, some of them are maybe from Tapajung here, okay, so Tapajung, neighboring countries China and Nepal, Walung Chungola, have been connected through a road network. The road construction initiative that started some 7 months ago from Tiptala at the Nepal-China border point was completed on Friday by constructing up to Walung Chungola. The vehicles from the Chinese contracting company arrived in Walung Chungola on the 22nd of July 2017, carrying heavy equipment, including excavator, after opening the road track, giving a sense of elation to the folks. Okay, so the local residents enjoyed the whole night on Friday after connecting their remote village to China via road network. It is said that 30 million rupee plus amount was spent to construct the 30 kilometers road from Tipta to the human settlement in Walung Chungola. Chairman of Road Users Committee, Chetan Balung, said that the members of Walung Committee have invested two-thirds more than the state's amount. He shared that 25 million rupees was collected from the Walung community. Likewise, the remaining over amount was received from the Parliamentary Development Fund and the then BDC office. Meanwhile, the road to Walung Chungola from district headquarters, Pumling, has been developed up to Tapetok of Phatanglung Rural Municipality. Okay, so so this is seen from the end. Walung Chungola is a bit behind. Well, so with the opening of a new highway on the ancient Tipta Pass, which was up now one of the so-called remotest area on Nepalese borders, I can tell it is remote. I mean, in 1980, it was very, very difficult to have access from Tapajung to Walung Chungola. We can define, I try to define, the true nature of capital, the capital, and the way it produces constantly new form of inequalities. The private financement of this road appears to be in contradiction with the promises of economic returns to the people. Why? Because you understand that they had to do themselves a massive financial investment to have access to new forms of consumerism which flows from China, from the Chinese border, which is just on the north. The way downwards to Nepal and Tapajungola being nearly inaccessible since a long time. Underlying the question of the nature of the capital invested in roads and the conditions of its produce accumulation, we can redefine also the question of the remoteness of a place. What does it mean, a remote place, globally, in this Himalayan area of ancient trade? It is a social and political process rather than a primordial condition. Isolation and remoteness on these frontiers have been both conditions of intensification of accumulation of capital and political power, and parallelly of marginalization, you know, accumulation of capital and political power, and also marginalizations usually goes together, debt and bonded work. So what I try to describe here, it is what we could call a frontier capitalism, frontier capitalism. There is a long history of the accumulation of wealth and capital through a long distance trade on high Himalayan passes. We have a colleague from Netherlands, he passed away now, but Wim van Spengen was been inquiring a lot about this ancient trade. So in Walungchungola, a great number of rich traders and emigrants became financial capitalists abroad, able today to invest locally millions of Nepali rupees. You can understand that this investment of a huge amount of rupee, it does not come from the local place, it comes from investment abroad, of course. Some of them are still living side by side with poor and ordinary yak herders and traders, for whom transaction in cash money is a recent practice. So you have both together, living together still now, people who are able to invest millions of rupee and people who are simple yak herders and were not used to use cash money. So to trace the history of this phenomenon back, I shall distinguish between ancient mercant capitalism and state capitalism, which are two different things. I shall take also examples in different spheres of activities to show the difference between ancient economic practices, which are always embedded with religion, and this new kind of very lucrative frontier economy today, which relies on the flow of growing capital based on money and separation between investors and workers with indebted peasants at the bottom end. So I put together an enlarged map of the area, it's Tapeljung and Walungchungola with Tapas, and the new, this kind of new road now, which are traced really fast, you know, from Tibet side. So what is ancient mercant capitalism? So I go from micro level to macro level, right? So I pass from very micro level to macro level. So much before what has been called roughly the developmentist years, it was in the 1960s, we had a coexistence of ancient and rich monastic establishments which acted as banks to guarantee transactions between traders as well as guardian of gifts. You know, in the monasteries, they were also doing transactions, you know, and they were kind of keepers of also of gold, statues, art crafts, which were done to the monastery. But they could do a money lending also. Gifts were sources of income as well as prestige, status. Today, we see the disparition of any kind of connectivity between donators and gift receivers, between house and the temple. So the new investors and out-migrants and the workers who continue to live in the village are completely separated in time and space. So I want to show how this transformation is linked to the functionment of pre-state forms of living tributes and taxes in Nepal and in Tibet, although these pre-state forms of taxation can be still in close connection with the way the modern state is living tributes. Okay, so today you understood that the people are compelled to invest themselves privately in road infrastructures. It is a big transformation. You know, before people were obliged to build paths, you know, people, they had also to provide some free labor sometimes, right, for religious establishment. Now let's change level and let's go to the macro level. Explanation. So I try to resituating ancient Nepalese, Tibeto, Sikkimese, and Marwari capitalists in a global and modern international economic context. So you understand now that I am giving you a paper on anthropology of economics. So what are the inequalities of development explained through the creation of free trade zones in the years 1960? After the Second World War, the deficit in Asia had been financed largely by the American policy. The crisis of the dollar in the 1960s put an end to this help, except for the countries linked to the war in Indochina, Southeast Asia. Meanwhile, and because of the failure or total lack of agrarian reform, like in Nepal, for instance, in the 60s, the agrarian reform, which failed actually in the 60s, although it was an attempt to do, it was the same for politically colonized Tibet, the South Asian countries, they knew a massive rural emigration towards urban areas or abroad in search of livelihood. Technological backwardness and deficient banking system were to push the adoption of new strategies in Asia oriented towards exportation. A frantic search for foreign capitals started to convince the people to make and export themselves their produce. The dominated economies should give their best resources, their manpower, a docile and abundant labor force, and all kinds of fiscal advantages and guarantees of stability were granted to them on condition to treat within the international capital. So in fact, it was the international investors who were playing the game. It was urgent to insert South Asian countries in the globalized finance and to ignore protectionism. There was a lot of protectionist policies also in Southeast Asia, but this globalized finance system break, you know, this protectionism. So in the case of Nepal and its Tibetan bordering countries, this protectionism was to last much beyond the 60s. I remember that in the 1980s, here there was a very strong protectionist policy still. So it can explain the double rate of backwardness of the economy of the country. So, okay, so here it's a map which give you approximately the Southeast Asian countries which are involved into this kind of investment. Okay, so now just some definition about capitalism in Nepal and Tibet. So capitalism in Nepal and its Tibetan border area started, like in India, much before the opening of the country to the world in 1950. Of course, you know, it is usual to say that Nepal opened its borders in 1950 to foreigners, but in fact capitalism has started much earlier. And it waited until 1980 to intensify. The government of some of the Hindu monarchy of Nepal had adopted the open market system, and this capitalist transition started immediately to erode the global rural economy, and eventually the cultural basis of crafts and cottage industries, as well as many other non-agricultural pursuits. So I give some... I bent on Chaitanya Mishra's definition of capitalism. We have known each other, and now we met each other with Chaitanya Mishra professor. He gives a good definition of capitalism in the 60s in Nepal. You can copy it, or I don't read that, but I give you time, you know, maybe to read it on the screen. So machines, commodities and services and benefits of large scale production gradually replaced both workers and producers. The result was widespread deindustrialization and de-skilling and expanded seasonal underdevelopment of rural and agricultural societies. So if capitalism has been the economic system of the greatest number of countries since the collapse of planned socialist economies in Central and Asian Europe, symbolized by the fall of Berlin Wall in 1989, we must talk also in account the inequalities of development of these modernized capitalist areas and the creation of new forms of remoteness in the wake. Okay, so now let's go again to the micro level. I show you here pictures that I have done at different periods in Walunchungola. So this village of Walunchungola was, it was a dream for me to get in 1980. And then when I arrived in the village, so the picture which is the most on the upper side, this was done in 1980, this is Beaumont, the girls weaving carpets. At that time, in 1980, many women were employed in the weaving carpet industry. So in the remotest place of Nepal, you know, it was very common to see the women weaving for selling carpets abroad. And the other photograph I took recently, because I could reach again Walung Chungwala only in 2014, 6 years ago. Then the other photos were from 2014. So the village did not change really between 1980 and 2014. I was so amazed when I could reach again the country, this village, after so long time. And so you see people are still practicing a kind of local economy, you know, bargaining for buying daily vegetables and selling also charm that they produce themselves at home. And also the yak trade, which is still going on to the border in 2014. So now the Himalayan traders confronted to the effects of a growing monetization in Nepal in 1965. So there was a growing monetization, cash money was entering. So what happened in the 1960s, 65s? Another consequence of capitalism in Nepal-Himalayan borders was to break the links between household organization and its territoriality. It started to break, if you want, the organization between household economy and territoriality. It created a partially waged labor force, partially waged, because people were making some wages for working outside but then coming back to the village, like in Nepal, in other districts. And to allow more accumulation and profit, this time to the brokers who control the migration labor force. So household participation in the labor force was more and more stratified, elders and youngers being sometimes completely dissociated in their out-migration trajectories. Old people were remaining in the village, younger ones were migrating. So if you see the situation in this village of Walung Chungwala, it is amazing because now only women are staying in the village. Elder ones, and all the young ones have migrated abroad. Sometimes they come back, but you know the dissociation is really important. So the emigration of rural workforce towards urban areas did not stop to increase and to shift from farm wage to non-farm wage. For the foreign investors, the afflux of foreign capital should improve the terms of exchange and help to catch up the most industrialized countries. Okay, so again about this kind of mercant capital. Let's go now have a look about the close relationship between religion, politics, and economy. And here we go back, if you want, to the 17th century. What I show you here is on the right side, this is a statue of Lhatsun Namgyal Jigme. It is the lineage of famous Nyingmapa lineage of the Pelli Tulku, who was ruling over monasteries in North Sikkim, where I have been working also, Central Tibet and Nepal. It is the same lineage which came from Sikkim when, in the 17th century, when the Dalai Lama was also, the fifth Dalai Lama was installed in Tibet. And there were some Tibetan lineages who went to Sikkim. And the same lineage went also in northeastern part of Nepal, in Walung Chungwala area. So there were some establishments, religious establishments, starting 17th, 18th century, very rich monastic establishments who were set up there. So it is important, you know, to do this link because it is unusual to do this link. I mean, it has been done by Tibetologists when they translate the text, but me, I do it. To explain what happened on the sociological side. So, the whole area of Walung Chungwala till the Makalu was strictly linked to the Buddhist kingdoms of Sikkim and Tibet through this religious link. So, if one goes back to the religious and political activities in the 17th century, the whole area till the Makalu was linked to Buddhist kingdoms of Sikkim and Tibet. and considered as a bayul, a hidden place, as they say in Tibetan. It saw the arrival of the Khartan Pelri Latsunam Kajikme, lineages recognized by the fifth Dalai Lama and the construction of important monastic establishments, key point between a loosely defined ecclesiastical Tibetan state since the 17th century, and later, don't forget also, the growing influence of British Indian and Chinese imperial powers in the long century between 1850 and 1950. Long century where you had the growing influence of Chinese imperial powers and British Indian Company also, which were playing game. So from an economic point of view, it was one of the most important paths run by the ancient communities in the Himalayas, with a long history of transborder merchants, some of them giving rise to famous and long-standing trading communities, able to accumulate huge merchant capital, in spite of many historical fault lines and local conflicts and international wars between the ancient kingdoms of Nepal, Sikkim, and Tibet. I say kingdoms because at that time Nepal was a kingdom, Tibet and Sikkim as well. So, among a great diversity of merchants, so who are the merchants? Trading people. Marwari from Rajasthan initially. Brahmini in New York, in Newari from Nepal, Tibetans, urban and rural traders. So we have to define which sorts of commodities gave way to an accumulation of resources, able to allow some of them owners to become international businessmen. So you don't become international businessmen with any kind of products, you know. So some were more prized, like jewels, gold, of course. So we must do distinction between different sort of colonial resources. We have to distinguish between, for instance, gold, jewels, and spices. I will get to spices soon. So, which gave rise to international business and local artifacts, which could be immediately reinvested locally. So, there was also, I will go into details soon. So overall, we must do a difference. We must insist on the difference between state capitalism and mercant capitalism. And state capitalism and mercant capitalism. And we have to trace the link between the states or pre-states and the different trading actors in their context. Okay. Both pictures I did not do myself, of course, but I have scanned in a famous book which has been published by Rana. Here's a very interesting book with a lot of illustrations of how it, the Nepalese forms of state capitalism under the Rana and the regional mechanism of police control of the borders between Nepal and Tibet. So I put together some pictures of Jungpa Rana, with Madaba Rani at that time, and so you know the story, history of Nepal, of course. And then on the left side, other side, some political tractation during the Second World War with, I don't remember the name of this, Rana, maybe someone knows his name, no? The one on the top side, the right side. Thank you. And and I put together the family of the last Goa of Walusundola near the Tip Tapas, both that I met in 1980. So in 1980 in Walusundola there were still the family of the last Goa, the chief, head chief of Walusundola, who was retired in Kathmandu at that time. And I met with his close cousins, and I stayed in their house. I could stay only 15 days because there was a police checkpost at that time, and they were so surprised to see me arriving in this village, how I had reached there. So I was looked after very much. But anyway, I could stay 15 days at the time, and this family of the Goa gave me a lot of interesting information about the kind of work they were doing on the borders and how they were acting precisely as tax collectors in this place. So, for this Walunga or Walunga, it was a strategic location near easy passages into Tibet. But it was, in fact, it was but a matter of time before the ruling elite in Kathmandu, the ruling elite, the Rana, realized the potential benefits of an active containment policy. Here, today also, you know, with this virus, we have also benefits of a containment policy. It's very interesting to do a link, you know. The often tense situation between Nepal and Tibet since the end of the 18th century led to a situation in which specific privileges were conferred on persons or groups that could positively contribute to the upholding of Nepalese territorial rights. So these people, they could help the Rana to control the territory, of course, because there had been many wars between Tibet and Nepal, as you know. So, for instance, the Sino-Nepalese War of in the 18th century, which was caused by a number of factors, including high tariffs on trans-Himalayan trade through Nepal, the devaluation of the Tibetan currency, and the opening of the Chumbi Valley. It was against Nepalese interest, so there was a heavy war about these trade traffics. You have many informations in Thailand, 1991, so which aimed at the invasion of Sikkim by the Gurkha. So these internal or external factors of state articulations and wars seem to have provided for favorable conditions of early capital formation among the inhabitants of these particular frontiers from the 19th century up to the 20th century. Maybe I shorten a little bit. I don't realize how much I have to shorten my talk because I don't want to I give the main articulations of this paper.
You had 45 minutes, actually.
I have talked already 45 minutes?
No, you had 45 minutes, but you can go up to 1 hour. It is up to you.
So the Gowa, chief stack collectors and traders in their house in Wanjungola. So at that time, in 1980, remember that in 1980, in China, it was the restoration of Deng Xiaoping. Deng Xiaoping, he was the one who opened again the market to capitalism. He started to reinstall capitalism in China. And at that time, it was the time where I got to these borders. So you see, this is from 1980, this picture. They were still able now to trade between Nepal and Tibet, because it had been closed during the occupation of Tibet with Maoist troops. So these pictures are from 1980. So they were still bringing goods in Nepal. Just remember that all these people were from Tibetan, the Gowa, they were from Tibetan origin. They had installed this village in the 19th century, and they had been conferred a lot of benefits as police. They were police controlling the borders, tax holders, and traders themselves. So tax collectors. So these big men, they could free themselves from the tax-paying estate holders and the dependence of district officers, and they soon adopted as hooker, you know, hooker, the British traveler to Nepal and Sikkim. Hooker has met also with the Gowa, and he explained that they soon adopted the British soft manners, as Hooker has put it, when he was received by the Gowa around the Kanchenjunga. After Hooker, there was an Austrian anthropologist whose name is Führer Heimendorf, you must have heard about. He inquired in Sherpa area. Yeah. So Führer Heimendorf has been also in this place in 1957. And interestingly, he noted their collection of huge amount of all kinds of goods and resources, even on an international level. At that time, it's amazing because this Gowa, they had also money in cash. They had paper money also in the 1950s. Let's go fast now a little bit again about this ancient kind of capitalism, state capitalism. So What is the role of the Gorkha rulers of Nepal in money lending? This I will shorten because it is so money lending, in fact, had developed already sufficiently in the early 17th century to necessitate the enactment of legislation seeking to control rates of interest. So in the 17th century, in Nepal, there was the king Ram Shah, and it is under King Ram Shah rule that one prescribed the rate on cash loans at 10% every year, and twice the amount of the principal if payments had accumulated. So there was already in the 17th century this police taxation police, you know, which is interesting to remember for studying this kind of mercant capitalism. So there were markets in land as well as in loan. Coins were minted in the three kingdoms of the Kathmandu Valley. You know that these are the Newari who started to come. So Kathmandu Valley was located on the main trade road between India and Tibet, and it has a great importance also to remember. So here I have put together pictures from the 1980 when I did my fieldwork among Kabeval and Chok Korea, and both people, of course, they were it was a situation before the developmental years. They had not any use for cash. So now a glimpse on who are these traders. Those traders, in fact, I was lucky enough to meet some of them directly in Sikkim. When I was in Sikkim, I started to go to Sikkim in 1990, and I met with some Marwari traders who were coming to Sikkim for trading directly. What? What do you think? What they were trading in both forests? Cardamom. Okay, so now let's turn to this cardamom spice trade. So I met with one on the way, and it was very interesting because he was coming directly to buy the cardamom crop to young people working in the forest, and they were not Lepcha, they were Nepali. So who are these Marwari? It's very interesting because they are one of the most ancient capitalists in India, and up now, you know, so they are. They are classified as Baniya in the Hindu code and members of strictly hierarchical guilds, Maharjan, of merchants. So their profession is called Sharad. Today they own 52 industrial groups among the 77 most important ones. So their capital in stock exchange represents 60% of the total of 9% of the Indian PIB, which is still a lot. Anyhow, now they are very much superseded by Chinese because this cardamom crop business now it has moved to southeastern part of China. Still, it is important in Nepal, but what is interesting also to mention here, because I was explaining the relationship between religious establishment and trade. So the Marwari are Jain and Buddhist. And although Buddhists are often portrayed as rejecting the material world in favor of spiritual pursuits, Buddhism, as with all of our religions, has always necessarily been deeply embedded within not only economic, but also political and social spheres in the various contexts in which Buddhism has taken root. So some scholars have even suggested that at the time of the Buddha, the widespread introduction of monetary currency accompanying the shift to an agrarian society and consequent urbanization in India had created the circumstances for the Buddha's rejection of medical entrenchment of social hierarchies. Mm-hmm. So this is, I mentioned here, Chakravarti, 1987, Bailey and Mabet, 2003, Benavides, 2005. We have a lot of stuff now about the relationship between trade, commerce, economy, religion, Buddhist countries. You have understood that Buddhist monasteries in Asia have been historically large economic centers, owning great plots of land and occupying a central position on regional trade routes, and monasteries and monks have been engaged in economic activities and have played a significant economic roles in society. To illustrate what I was explaining you now, about this capitalism of goods, I show you here some pictures of Wolnchungola in 2014. So this is the big monastery of Wolnchungola, which is still there, which was badly destroyed several times by earthquake in 2008. It is still, but inside, you know, all the statues are sparse and have been removed since a long time. So between 1980 and 2014, so down there it is 1980 and 2014. And this picture is from Führerheim and Love in 1957. Inside the monastery, it was lavishly furnished with a lot of statues. So all these monastic establishments, of course, they were also under the control of the Goa. So there was a link between the Goa and the religious powers who were acting. So now, let's go a little bit quicker. So now, I go to, my main point is territorial destructuring and transformation of transborder communities between 19th and 21st centuries, money lending, rent, forced labor, and debt. So here I show you some pictures of the Lepcha community. So I went to Sikkim starting in 1990. So I went several times, and finally I could go to the most restricted area, which is north of Sikkim. It's called Zonggu. And I could enter Zonggu after 10 years because it was very close. So in Zonggu, I could understand a bit how Lepcha community were working, doing harvest, building houses, and how they were also involved into this capitalism of spices since a long time. I can bring to explain more. Okay, so the cardamom trade and what is the importance of this kind of for our topic about capitalism of spices? So, in fact, not only Lepcha but Limbu, many Limbu, have been involved into this cultivation of cardamom. There have been now many studies, several studies and dissertations done about cardamom crop and how cardamom is able also to classify. To reclassify population as a class, proletarian working people, instead of ethnic, territorially based, you know, like it was the case before. So it is the cardamom, in fact, which has changed a lot of rules and among the Limbu of Nepal, especially. Peasants have been encouraged to extend the cultivated area and to be involved into this kind of cultivation of cardamom. So what happened among the Limbu? The Limbu were like Tamang. They had their own ancient kipat land property. So this kipat property, they disappeared. It was completely finished in 1960. But still, it was people were still owning their land. But what happened, in fact, what they were doing on these lands, you know. So the Limbu, especially the Limbu, they were obliged. In fact, their land had been transformed into a haikar because they had debts. They were obliged to mortgage their land. And for paying mortgage, they had also to accept to cultivate this new introduced kind of spices, cardamom. So the origin of this cardamom, in fact, it is what some of my colleagues don't even realize. In fact, it is a colonial spice. You know, it was introduced by the British Indian Company, long time ago, because it was cultivated also in Kerala, in South India. So it came to Nepal through Ilam, through Sikkim, Many Nepali workers were in Sikkim already since a long time, and they became also cultivators of cardamom. So for all those Lepcha Limbu workers, in fact, cultivating cardamom, in fact, was just a reason to be more involved into a system of debt and forced labor, because they had no other means of keeping their land than working for spice shared cropping. So this, if you want now, we can do a link between the state capitalism, which in fact is a system of extracting both labor and profit from land, and a peasantry put into debt. Compulsory labor was an intimate part of peasants' lives already in the 60s. It started with the Gorkhali Hindu conquest and the extension of a state control over the land. Marwari merchants and traders of cardamom could easily expand their capitalist abilities in such Himalayan natives and peasant areas. I have not been too much into details, but we can argue and talk and I can explain more when we discuss it. So now I come to my conclusion. Free trade zones and the reduction of the autochthonous populations through international trade of spices. The highlands are incorporated into global markets through their politically engineered remoteness, in which various local actors, brokers and go-betweens, including low and not so low level state officials, hold the stake. Remoteness, in other words, may serve to keep transnational economies partly hidden in the shadow. Taking into consideration geographical, historical, and economical conditions of life on these frontiers, I try to give some key assets to understanding how the forging of frontier of economies are intrinsically tied to global capitalism. In Sikkim, cardamom cultivation was introduced by the Nepalese colonists, Nepalese colonists brought by British, of course, to Sikkim, especially what's his name, Claude White, one of the famous one, who went with many Newari and other Nepali to Sikkim in order to cultivate. So they were brought there by the British, who wanted to increase the population in this country and to organize a docile and resistant manpower to fight Tibetan landlords, preventing them to enter Sikkim. Introduction of this cultivated plant in Sikkim dates back to the end of the 19th century, after the annexation of the city of Darjeeling by the British Company of India in 1828. Some Sikkimese brothers, the Kensapa brothers, which were opposed to the royal family of Sikkim, contributed to settle some Nepalese cultivators on their lands. So North Sikkim is close to the islands of Tibet, a distinct eco-zone from which many a special product could be procured to India since a long time. Trade was of a luxury nature, goods of low weight for value like musk, rhubarb, gold and precious stones dominating the scene. Cardamom entered the game and soon helped to destroy not only local wealth and resources, like a huge quantity of medicinal plants, but also forested areas, as well as people's future. When I traveled the first time in Kanchenjunga area, I still remember the luxury of the forest which were there. It was absolutely, really a wonderful, most beautiful primitive forests were still there in 1980. In 2014, you still have forests, but all the underwoods are invested now with cardamom. It's growing everywhere, and it is destroying the soil because it is making too much acidity to the soil. So nothing else can be cultivated now but this cardamom, ginger, of course. Of course, so now people, they can get some work for helping to prepare this cardamom, which is a long process. But, I mean, the future of the environment is very much compromised, you know, through this kind of colonial space. So, in fact, the introduction of cardamom in the northern district of Zonggu in Sikkim ought to represent first a raise in the Lepcha and Limbu economic level of life. Of course, many people, they got much richer, you know. They cultivated principally cereals before, and they lived on the numerous resources of the forest. But they knew perfectly. So the cardamom was unknown to them. So when the lepcha, they started to also be put into debt with these cardamom crops, they did not know, they still use the Nepali name for cardamom, which is elanchi.
Alaichi. Elanchi. 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 Elanchi.
And they adopted also the Nepalese beliefs and rituals surrounding the cultivation and use of a plant. Before, they had to do some animal sacrifice every year in honor of the spirit of a plant. But they assimilated to the spirit of death. Okay. So you see how local people have to adapt progressively to this new kind of resource coming from abroad. So now, my conclusion, let's go again to our road infrastructures and international trade. When spices like motorable roads become synonym of debt and death, I am very pessimistic. Like in many parts of rural Nepal and Sikkim in the years 1980, money was of no use. You know, since 1980, cash money was of no use in many, many rural parts of Nepal. Cash was still rare in remote areas, far from roads and transportation, and when earned through short-time employment outside the village, it was reintroduced only in form of useless items, luxury commodities. Marwari at that time were also money lenders and pawnbrokers, and they had the monopoly of cardamom sale in Sikkim. So the lepcha who ignored countability and Marwari language, they fell into irreversible system of death and forced labor. So at that time there was a system of credit and rates which could go up to 25%. So if some lepcha were borrowing some money or some goods, they had to pay 25% more when they were. Okay, so you know the system of debt has been widespread all over the world. It was exactly the same for indigenous Indian of North America. It has been the same also in Europe for the colonies, you know, the system of land money. It's something which has really reduced people to debt. It is still the same now in Katmandu. So if we take the example of the lepcha, when they were caught in hands of traders, it was nearly impossible to help them to get out of Maori's grasp. Okay. The same story will be repeated, I think. So my conclusion it is that I suspect that now the same story will be repeated with the arrival of a road in Walungshungola and the inevitable development of Chinese food industry compared with what people were producing locally. I have seen already how the yak herders, all these people from Walungshungola still doing this trade with yak, you know, on both sides of the borders, are now obliged to exchange local goods, which are locally produced, organic food, they exchange for beer, industrially processed in China. I saw that on many parts of the borders. In Rasuwa it is the same, because I inquired also in the border of Rasuwa. So now there is a local kind of trade, you know, with industrially processed thing, and in exchange, good rice locally produced is given for nothing, in exchange of something which looks to be, of course, desirable. Everybody wants to drink Qingdao beer, but you can prefer to have your local Ji Chang homemade. This is my conclusion. Disaster of highways in all parts of the Himalayas.